Good afternoon, I'm Sumaira Abdi. You're watching MF Corner. On the show today, we're going to start off by talking about the difference between a mutual fund, a PMS or portfolio management service, and an AIF or alternative investment fund with Keetan Shah, Chief Financial Planner at SRE. And there's also a very interesting chat that's coming up a little later on the show. Kushal Baghi, co-founder of Tortuga Wealth Manager, says the buy and hold approach for equity mutual funds is a thing of the past. He says there is a more efficient approach that investors should be looking at. So that's on the show today. Let's get started. I don't have to explain a mutual fund, so let me get to PMS right away then. It's for the uninitiated, the PMS is a portfolio management service. It's a boutique investment vehicle offered by premium wealth managers where a customized plan is made to offer superlative returns to the discerning investor. So what's an AIF then? That's an alternative investment fund. It's a vehicle which has a pooled investment of funds which invest in non-conventional streams like maybe venture capital, private equity, hedge funds, etc. And they offer that extra edge to the sophisticated investor. So now that we know what each of these is, let me invite Keetan Shah, the Chief Financial Planner at SRE, to explain the suitability of each. Hi, Keetan. Good afternoon. You know, let's use the mutual fund as a benchmark because I think we have pretty much established, you know, the working and the virtues of the mutual fund quite a bit. So tell us, with the mutual fund as a benchmark, how does a PMS or an AIF stack up and who is it really intended for?
Thanks, Sumaira, for having me. Sumaira, we can compare mutual funds with PMS and AIF on six different parameters to start with. So like all of us know that mutual funds and AIFs are pooled account. Ideally, what happens is all our money is accumulated in one account and investments are done through that. Whereas PMS is an individual account in which, you know, the fund manager buys and sells in each individual's DMAT account. Also, the minimum investment required for a mutual fund is as low as 250 or 500 rupees. Whereas a PMS would require you to invest up to 50 lakhs. And AIF would expect you to invest up to a minimum of 1 crore. I think the most important point to look at while we try and compare each of these categories is the cost. Now, what happens in a mutual fund, like we all know, there is a fixed asset management fee which is charged, which roughly, if you talk about the top funds today, is close to 1.5%. But what happens in a PMS and an AIF is, in general cases, there is something called as a setup fee which is taken, which is equivalent to an entry load which existed in mutual funds in the past. So you first pay the setup fee, then there is this traditional AMC fee that you pay, and then there is also a performance fee which probably works beyond a watermark. So typically the way it works is, you know, the PMS or an AIF will sign saying that, you know, we'll charge you a performance fee if we are able to cross 12%, if that's the watermark. So on the cost aspect, PMS and AIFs are slightly costlier than mutual funds from that aspect. Also, while we look at exit loads, I think most mutual funds today offer a one-year kind of an exit load. But while you look at PMS, most of these PMS have exit loads up to 3 years. And in category 1 and 2 of AIFs particularly, there is a lock-in up to 7 years. So that's the differentiating factor when it comes to exit loads and lock-ins. Also, very importantly, what we have to understand is the taxation bit. Now, mutual fund is the most tax efficient amongst all of these three instruments, where in equity, you only pay at redemption, either long-term or short-term capital gains on equity. And on debt, it gets added to your income if it is less than 3 years, and you get indexation advantage if it is more than 3 years. But the way it is different in a PMS is, because it is transacted in your own account, every time you buy and sell, you will have to bear the short-term or the long-term capital gains in your account in a PMS. And AIF is slightly complicated. So if I talk about category 1 and category 2 on the taxation bit, then on the equity front, it works same like I explained to you in PMS. But in the debt side, irrespective of how much tenure have you had in terms of investment, the capital gains are directly added to your slabs. In category 3, because it is taxed as business income, and I'm assuming that somebody who's going to invest a crore will be in the highest tax bracket, ideally the individual will end up paying 42.7% tax on the capital gains, which is extremely high. The last point that I really want to highlight is leverage. So suppose if you invest 100 rupee in a mutual fund or a PMS, the fund can only invest up to 100 rupees. But in an AIF, and specifically category 3, this investment, because has a leverage, the fund manager can invest up to 200%. So 100 rupee invested can be leveraged up to 200% of investment. So I think this is broadly the difference between a mutual fund, PMS, and AIF. Now, to answer your second question of who this is actually meant for, I think this is slightly tricky. And I think this will depend on the asset allocation strategy of the individual. And hence, the financial advisor would be the right person to make the judgment. But if I have to talk about an HNI, I would typically bucket this into three asset allocations. First is 10% of his entire asset allocation can go towards probably emergency or short-term investments, which can be taken care of by mutual fund. The core portfolio, which I believe should be 70% of the portfolio, can also be taken care of by mutual fund. The remaining 20% can get allocated to a mutual to a PMS or an AIF, which is broadly a tactical portfolio. And this should only be done by people who probably believe that mutual funds are not able to offer a solution. And hence, I would rather look at 10% in emergency, 70% in core portfolio, both managed by mutual funds, and remaining 20% can go to a PMS or an AIF.
So, Kirtan, what you're saying is that not even all the portfolios, right? Only a very aggressively tuned portfolio. Of that also, only 20% for tactical positioning, and of that also perhaps 10 to 20% in either PMS or AIF, right? And I myself have not understood this need for that very focused approach, because I have a focused fund for that, or even looking at a very exotic option because the downside is almost endless. So what is it that has led to this big surge in the assets that are now being managed? I mean, if you just look at the last 4-year period, there has been a 10, 20 time increase in the assets or more?
So Sumaira, I think the first logic is very clear. SEBI has come out very strongly with respect to total expense ratio and hence distribution commission on the MF side. So I would personally like to believe a lot of distribution business has moved towards PMS and AIF, where commissions are not slacked as much as they are in MF. So that is one reason. But another reason also is that if I look at an asset allocation with respect to, let's say, debt or equity, there are a couple of areas that MFs are not able to solve. So let's say, for example, like you rightly pointed out, that you have a focus fund. But if you look at the broad industry today, most focus funds today are large cap heavy. And hence, there is probably not a solution with mid cap and small cap in terms of investing in a multi-cap fashion. So I think a mid-cap, small-cap fund, generally in the mutual fund space, would have a liquidity challenge because it's a pool account. And also categorization is an issue because of SEBI. I think that is where a mid-cap, small-cap PSU, probably trading in the client's account, can come into picture for a couple of clients. And also if you look at the AIF space, Sumaira, there are two particular things that I like to highlight, which probably, again, mutual fund does not have an offering for. One is a venture capital or a pre-IPO kind of investment. And the second is the long shot funds, is where I think AIFs can come into picture. But again, like I said, this is only meant for aggressive investors having at least a 5 crore, 10 crore plus portfolio to do investments in. But to a greater extent, I would like to believe 70-80% of the asset allocation can be taken care of by mutual fund in itself. And like I said, 20% can go towards tactical allocation to probably a PMS or an AIF.
Okay, Kirtan, there has been this buzz on and off that, SEBI may introduce direct plans for PMS and AIF. As well, there is talk that, broker fee may be capped for these two services. Do you think, one, that it's likely, and could the introduction of these moves actually bring them on a more level playing field with the mutual funds, and at least, the very aggressive marketing would normalize?
Sumaira, I think a major part of level playing field is splitting to two, in my opinion. First is categorization, and then, of course, is TER rationalization. I think there is no apple-to-apple comparison between mutual funds and PMS, as mutual funds don't really have the flexibility because of the categorization by SEBI. and that is where PMS I think is able to score, and which is why that is not applicable to PMS. So I think till the time the categorization bit is not solved in PMS, I think level playing field, at least on that front, is not something that I really think is the way we should look at it. But definitely, if TERs are rationalized, commissions are rationalized, I think to a greater extent that marketing effort, which is currently bringing in a lot of business to PMS and AIF, will definitely have a relook on it.
Right, Kirtan, thanks very much for joining in and explaining the very basics of this mutual fund PMS AIF debate. Thanks much indeed. With that, we'll take a very quick break. On the other side, there's a very interesting chat lined up. Has the era of buy and hold, at least as far as equity mutual funds are concerned, over? Is there a newer, more efficient alternative now available? We'll find out on the other side. Joining in will be Kushal Baghi of Tortuga Wealth. Stay tuned. Hi, welcome back. You're watching MF Corner. Well, so far we have spoken about the difference between a mutual fund, PMS, and an AIF. So now let's talk about something very, very interesting. So far, all that we have heard about long-term wealth creation is that you have to buy and hold, that you buy now and remain invested for the long term. In the short term, you will see some bit of volatility, but over the longer period, the trend is always up, and therefore you will manage and get those compounded returns and benefit over the longer period. But you must have the discipline to remain invested. Don't keep taking out your money. But my next guest, Kushal Baghi, the co-founder at Tortuga Wealth Managers, says that it's time to toss this theory out of the window. Kushal, hi, good afternoon. Well, this certainly sounds very, very controversial, at least now. So tell us, if not buy and hold, then what?
Thanks, Sumaira, for having me over. So if not buy and hold, there's a different approach to tackling the problem of asset allocation, which, you know, I sort of believe is the prime driver of investment and portfolio returns. And we're saying that this asset allocation models is best done using quant techniques. So I'll dive into as to buy and hold. What are the two, three inefficiencies or lacuna that I see in buy and hold? And the first is that it has no risk management in place. You know, as a strategy used in equity markets, which are considered risky, the default sort of strategy being offered today does not have any risk management in place, which means, you know, drawdowns keep happening in the market, and they happen all the time. Big drawdowns happen more often than we realize. And if you are going to remain invested, the bad news is that, yeah, I mean, although it's a disciplined strategy, it's going to take you through all the downs in the market. And some of these downs can be extremely painful. You know, your money has to work much harder to get back the amount that it's lost. And having no risk management hurts buy and hold as an approach to long-term investing. It leads me to the second point, that if it is going to drag you through all the downs in the market, it's emotionally a very hard strategy to follow, right? I mean, it's great to follow when the markets are going up because everybody is making money. When the markets go down 5, 10%, one can still stomach it because, well, markets are supposed to be volatile. The problem happens when the drawdowns start increasing to 15% and 20%, and when we have quite a recent memory of what's happened in the market due to COVID. And the data very conclusively shows that, you know, whether it's in India or whether it's in the US, that people tend to ditch the strategy at the wrong time, as a result of which you land up earning lesser returns than the mutual fund itself. And therefore, because this has been happening for decades, the business of investing in mutual funds hasn't really excited somebody as much because the returns haven't been exciting enough. And finally, the third point about this is that buy and hold fails to take valuations into consideration. You know, it says because you should be remain invested all the time. Again, once again, the data is very clear that if you start an investment at higher valuations, your returns are going to be much less than when you start at lower valuations. So the whole premise is that if the risk-reward sort of ratio, if I can call it that, is different across different levels of valuation, then remaining invested at the same allocation across different levels of valuation is not such a hot idea.
No, it makes sense. But, you know, I mean, putting theory to practice is a whole different ballgame. So tell us, what exactly is this quant-based investing?
Great. So I think the first thing is to understand that if the risk of equity is different at different levels of valuation, you must make some adjustments to your exposure. Right? That is, when valuation levels look unsavory or are exorbitant, you should look at reducing exposure and waiting for times to sort of scalp the volatility rather than ignoring the volatility. This traditionally can't be done by market timing, you know, or trying to predict the market. So quant, which is the answer, is more of a rule-based system. I'll tell you three or four different steps in a quant-based approach. And the first is that you've got to look for patterns in data that exist in the equity markets. Now, everybody is looking for their own patterns of data. Everybody looks at what works best for themselves. But it's really important to understand what the patterns are that you're looking for and why the patterns exist. You know, when the patterns sort of form themselves, you sort of have to look for your edge. An edge is simply defined as the probability of one event happening over another, right? And this edge has to have existed historically, and it also should be sustainable into the future, because if you're going to keep changing your edges all the time, you're going to keep changing your models all the time, and then that's not a winning strategy. After you've identified your edges, you actually have to simply patiently wait for your patterns to appear. You have to wait for those moments where probabilities and opportunities offer you chances, where probabilities for success are heavily and irresistibly loaded in your favor. And once those patterns do appear, you must have the discipline to act. This is probably the most important part, that you have to have the discipline to act. You cannot have any discretion. Because once again, you know, like I alluded to in buy and hold, that if you can't follow a strategy, then there's no point having a strategy in the first place. Okay. I'm going to just see and end this point. Sorry.
Go ahead.
Yeah. You know, where he said that the success and key to long-term investing is to have a decision-making framework, a sound intellectual decision-making framework, and keep human emotions and biases as far as corroding that framework as possible. And therefore, the only answer and the way to sort of solve this problem is a quant-based approach.
Well, you know, easier said than done, right? Yeah. I guess, yeah, if somebody else was doing it for you, it would make it simpler. But, you know, Kushal, the, one of the reasons we've been told also not to churn very often is that it becomes very, very expensive, right? So how much is the outgo for somebody to follow this, you know, the quant approach? I mean, in the long term, how much are you really benefiting after having paid, you know, maybe an exit load or some taxes?
Yeah, so you're absolutely right. If you are going to be a little bit more active on your strategy, there are certain transaction costs, which typically in mutual fund comes under loads and taxes, right? So the strategy that you have to adopt obviously has to outperform a buy and hold by at least this amount, which is your behind. I think the key over here is that you can't be very indiscriminate. You know, you are waiting for certain high probability moments. These moments don't come very often. And when they come, you act. The two things, one is that over a long period of time, because most of the mutual funds follow a first in, first out method, the impact of loads and taxes are actually contained, right? So it isn't actually that much of a problem. The second thing is that if you have a strategy in place that is actually telling you when to sell, and if it is giving you good points or good exit points to sell, then it makes sense to pay the tax at that point in time, because the focus of your strategy is all of a sudden shifted to capital preservation, right? Just a quick example, right? I mean, this is obviously with hindsight bias, but at 11,800, 12,000, if you had managed to get even a little bit out of the market, you wouldn't have minded paying that tax, because what you're looking to eventually do is protect capital. And these large drawdowns typically all start at higher valuations. So again, it's an interesting one where, you know, you sort of have to change the way you think. You have to move away from this emotional-based decision-making and sort of surrender yourself to learn to think in terms of probabilities, which is not the easiest thing to do. Again, which is why you need a model.
Okay, what has been the success of this model? And, you know, is it only aimed at the more sophisticated HNI investor, or is there scope for a retail investor also to invest here?
Okay, so two things. So as far as the performance is concerned, the quant models typically have done well, right? They've been working as per design. And when I say working as per design, you're basically saying at very heated, exorbitant valuations, if you're in a bullish market, you might not make as much as the underlying because you're sitting partly in cash. But when market falls, you won't fall as much. And that's where you're essentially creating this alpha, if we can call it, over the underlying. The last 3-year track record that we have has actually seen a 3% to 8% CAGR outperformance over the underlying mutual funds or over the underlying portfolio. So that's as far as the performance is concerned. And as far as the retail and HNI go, currently we do have a minimum entry ticket size. Typically these models would be for a lot of people who invest in PMSs. But now, of course, because PMS, you need 50 lakhs to invest going forward. Ticket sizes of 20, 25 lakhs is what we would look to start off with.
Well, sounds good. Thanks very much for explaining it to us. So really, what you want to do is either try and reduce risk or increase returns, which is what we've been doing. But what Kushal promises is perhaps the holy grail, a little bit of both. Thanks very much. With that, we'll wrap up on MF Corner. Do stay tuned in. Closing Bell joins you next.